creature that we know is bound to end sometime in the rattle of the doormat, the sudden firelight, and the sight of familiar things greeting us as long absent travelers from far oversea. It went along steadily and silently, each of them thinking his own thoughts. The moles ran a good deal on quicker, as it was pitch dark, and it was all a strange country to him as far as he knew, and he was following obediently in the wake of the rat, leaving the guidance entirely to him. As for the rat, he was walking a little way ahead, as he said it was, his shoulders humped, his eyes fixed on the straight grey road in front of him, so he did not notice poor mole when suddenly someone reached him and took him like an electric shock. We others, who have lost more subtle physical senses, have not even proper terms to express an animal's into communications with his surroundings, living or otherwise, and have only the word smell, for instance, to include the little range of delicate thrills which murmur in the nose of the animal night and day, summoning, warning, inciting, rebelling. It was one of these mysterious fairy calls from out of the void that suddenly reached the mole in the darkness, making him tingle through and through with its familiar appeal, even while as yet he could not clearly remember what it was. He stopped dead in his tracks, his nose searching hither and thither in its efforts to recapture this fine element, the delicate current that so strongly moved him. A moment, and he had caught it again. And with it, this time came recollection in fullest flood. Home. That was what it meant. Those pressing appeals, those swift touches wafted through the air, those invisible little hands pulling and tugging all one way. Why, it must have cracked so sparingly at that moment, his old home that he had hurriedly forsaken and left sought again that day when he first found the rhythm. And now it was sending out its scouts and its messengers to capture him and bring him in. Since his escape on that bright morning, he had hardly given it a thought, so absorbed had he been in his new life, in all its pleasures, its surprises, its attraction, captivating experiences. Now, with the rush of old memories, how clearly it stood up before him in the darkness. Shabby indeed, and small and poorly furnished, and yet his, the home he had made for himself, the home he had been so happy to get back to after his day's work, and the home had been happy with him, too, evidently, and was missing him, and wanted him back, and was telling him so, through his nose, sorrowfully, reproachfully, there was no bitterness or anger, only the gentle reminder that it was there, and wanted him. The court was clear, the summons was plain, he must obey it instantly and go to the work, Ratty! He called, full of joyful excitement. Hold on! Come back! I want you quick! Oh, come along, won't you? Replied the rat cheerfully, still plodding along. Please stop, Ratty! Pleaded the poor mole in anguish of heart. You don't understand. It's my home! My old home! I've just come across the smell of it, and it's close by! Really quite close! I must go to it, I must. Oh, come back, Ratty! Please! Please come back!
The rat was by this time very far ahead, too far to hear clearly what the mole was calling, too far to catch the sharp note of painful appeal in his voice, and he was much taken up with the weather, for he too could smell something, something suspiciously like approaching snow.
Well, we mustn't stop now, really, he called back. We'll come for it tomorrow, whatever it is you've found. But I don't stop now, it's late, and the snow's coming on again, and I'm not quite sure of the way. And I want your nose, mole, so come on, quick, let's go.
And the rat pressed forward on his way without waiting for an answer. Poor mole stood alone in the road, his heart torn asunder, and a big sob gathering. Gathering,
field mice, replied the mole, with pride in his manner. They go round browsing irregularly at this time of the year. It's cute in these parts, but they never pass me over. They come to my land last of all, and I used to give them some drinks and supper too sometimes when I could afford it. Oh, it would be like old times to hear them again. This is not written, cried the rat, jumping up and running to the door. It was a pretty sight, and a seasonable one that met their eyes when they found the door open. In the forecourt, lit by the dim rays of a horn lantern, some 8 or 10 little field mice stood in a semicircle, red worsted comforters round their throats, and their forepaws whisked deep into their pockets, their feet jiggling for warmth. With bright, beady eyes, they glanced shyly at each other, sniggering a little, sniffing and applying the local leaves a good deal. As the door opened, one of the elder ones that carried the lantern was just saying, "Now, sir, 1, 2, 3! And forthwith, their shrill little voices uprose on the air, singing one of the old-time carols that their forefathers composed in fields that were fallow and held by frost, or went snowbound in chimney corners, and handed down to be sung in the miry street to lamp-lit windows at yule time. Villagers all, the frosty tide, let your door swing open wide, the wind may follow and snow beside, to draw us in by your bark, abide, with joy shall be yours in the morning. Here we stand in the cold and the sleet, blowing fingers and stamping feet, come from far away you to greet, you by the fire and we in the street, bidding you joy in the morning. Forever one half of the night was gone, sun the stars led the sun, raining bliss and then a sun, bliss tomorrow and more anon, joy for every morning. Goodman Joseph taught you the snow, saw the star or a stable low, Mary she might not rather go, welcome fats and litter below, joy was set in the morning. And then they heard the angels tell, who were the first to cry Noel, animals all as it befell in the stable where they did dwell, joy shall be there in the morning. Voices ceased. The singers, bashful but smiling, exchanged sidelong glances, and silence succeeded. But for a moment only. Then, from up above and far away, down the tunnel that they had so lately travelled, was borne to their ears in a faint musical thump, the sound of distant bells ringing, a joyful and clamorous peal. "Very well sung, boys," cried the rat loudly. "And now, come along in, all of you, and warm yourselves by the fire, and drink something hot. hypocrite. Everybody was set to do something, or perhaps something. In a very few minutes, supper was ready. The mole, as he took the head of the table in a sort of dream, saw a lengthy barren board set with savory comfits. So his little friend's face brightened, and beam as they fell to without delay. And then he let himself loose, for he was finished indeed on the provender so nicely provided, thinking why he should be homecoming as it turned out after all. As they ate, they talked of old times, and the field mice gave him the local gossip up to date, and answered as well as they could the 100 questions he had to answer them. The rat said little or nothing, only taking care that each guest had what he wanted, and plenty of it, and that Mole had no trouble or anxiety about anything. They cut it off at last, very grateful and showering wishes for the season, with their jacket pockets filled with remembrances for the small brothers and sisters at home. When the door had closed on the last of them, and the chink of the lanterns had died away, Mole and Rat picked the fire up, drew their chairs in, brewed themselves a last nightcap of mulled ale, and discussed the effects of the long day. At last the Rat, with a tremendous yawn, said, "Well, old Jack, I'm ready to go. Sleep is simply not the word. Let your own bunk over on that side. Very well, then. I'll take this. We don't get on the house this week. Everything is so handy." He clambered into his bunk and rolled himself well up in the blanket. And slumber gathered him forthwith as a swathe of barley is folded into the arms of every pink sheen. The weary mole also was glad to turn in without delay, and soon had his head on his pillow, in great joy and contentment. There he closed his eyes, he let them wander round his old room, mellow in the glow of the firelight that played or rested on familiar and friendly things which had long been unconsciously a part of him, and now smilingly received him back without rancor. He was now